Baquet. I request Dr. Sello Pondian to garland the speaker as a mark of our respect. I request the chairperson, Dr. Gopinath, to briefly introduce the topic. You are introducing the Sello Pondian, you are introducing the speaker, isn't it?
It's a great honor to introduce the speaker, my teacher, and a very renowned person in India and abroad. She is a director of Acer Chennai, and she was an assistant professor at Rush University Chicago till December 2003, a honorary clinical professor of medicine in Ramchandra Medical College, Chennai, and she's in the editorial board of Hormone and Metabolic Research and Journal of Association of Physicians of India, and she has received Otto Scovart's Best Teacher Award in Illinois Masonic Medical Center in 1987. She's been invited faculty for various national and international conferences. She has several national and international publications to her credit. And now I would hand out the proceedings with Dr. Gopinath.
Very important topic, very current, hot in diabetology is gliptins. How many of you are using gliptins liberally in this audience? Then you must listen to this lecture, because today gliptins is almost replacing sulfonylureas. Whether you believe it or not, both are secretagogues, but sulfonylurea taxes the pancreatic beta cells, tortures the beta cells and make them secrete, whereas gliptins pats the beta cells and make them secrete. So long-term control of diabetes will be better with gliptins. So a lot of new things are coming up. You can use gliptins in all stages of diabetes, even day 1, day 100, day 1000 of diabetes. And except, if you ask me what is the contraindication, there is only one contraindication for gliptins, that is pregnancy. So much so developments are there in the gliptins. You can liberate only except for the cost factor. You need not be afraid of any issues regarding gliptins. I mean, even recent paper I read yesterday, during acute infarction, they are suggesting the best anti-hyperglycemic drug is these incretin-based therapies. Probably next time you will be getting guidelines. You give some antibiotic drugs, and you write kind of GLP-1 agonist or DPP-4 inhibitors. So we are very happy to listen to a case-based approach for gliptins in the management of diabetes. Over to Dr. Sriram.
Good afternoon, everyone, and first my thanks to Dr. Raghunathan and Ramesh and the whole team for inviting me again to DiabeCon. I have been a part of DiabeCon ever since it started, and I enjoy every trip that I make, though they keep changing the it was in December, then it was in a different month, but I enjoy coming here every time. And when this topic was given to me by Dr. Raghunathan, my first reaction was, oh no, not again, not another gliptin talk for me. Why don't you give me something else? But but I have to speak on what I'm given. But I'm very happy to speak on this because, as Dr. Gopinath said, it is the new player in diabetes management, and we can use all the help that we can get. And how best to position this in the way we manage diabetes. And we know that, you know, concepts have changed. And new things are in our radar in terms of managing diabetes. So we'll move straight into this case-based approach to diabetes management. And what I want to say is, can you project this on both slides, both screens?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, then it'll be easier for people to see this. And yeah, so first thing I want to talk about is, diabetes comes in many shapes, sizes, forms, and gender, color, everything you can think of. There are many faces to diabetes management. And I think we all now agree on one thing, that diabetes management is classic people-centered medicine. And why I'm giving this preamble is, as we discuss the cases, we'll realize that, you know, people develop problems and then they become patients. And we as, and then they develop a relationship with us and we offer solutions to their problems. So no one's just a patient, they're actually a person who has a problem, then they become a patient and then they come to us, we offer a solution. So what is the solution that we are going to offer? And like I said, diabetes management used to be a very different approach even not long ago, even as early as just 20 years ago. All that we had was insulin and sulfonylureas, and then metformin, and then TZDs, and then incretin-based therapies, and analog insulins, and other agents, alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, so many things we have now. The ADA and the EASD, you know, recently, I think April 2012, has put out a position statement, which for the first time, ever since I have been practicing diabetes, I really believe they are spot on. So far, they have been giving so many different guidelines, and we have discussed them ad nauseum and dissected them. For the first time, I think they are spot on in terms of how to, you know, the concept. The downside of this new guideline, which I'll show you, is that it gives us, the physicians, a lot more latitude, but a lot less structure. So we have that, you know, you can choose this, 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 or this, but that's where we need to use our, you know, the knowledge and tailor it to the patient. And this is a thing just to show that diabetes management used to be sugar goes up, we use something, bring it down. It goes down, we stop taking that medicine, it comes up. So it was a constant roller coaster that was happening in people's lives. And there was never a smooth management of diabetes, and reaching the goal early on was never what happened to us. So today I have been asked to, as you can see in this ominous octet, there are so many different things that are making someone develop diabetes and then hyperglycemia. And we are going to focus on the gliptin-based therapy. And we all know that gliptins are this work on the incretin effect. And through that incretin effect, they have an effect on insulin production, they have an impact on glucose production from the liver, they have an impact on you know, on the weight, and so many different areas. So our focus today is going to be on the incretin effect, and so I'll go straight into the each one of these patients here. As I was mentioning to Dr. Raghunathan when he spoke to me a couple of weeks ago, each one of these patients is someone I have just seen in the last 3 to 4 months, and followed them up subsequently, and so I'll be able to actually tell you what happened to them. So let's go straight to the clinical scenario one, which is, and I want this to be highly interactive, and Raghu, I also have to thank you for another thing. Today I had a patient who came from Singapore who said he could not find me because he had seen me a long, long time ago in E.V. Kalyani Hospital. So he said he Googled my name and it took him straight to a YouTube Dibicon presentation. And it was in 4 parts, and he said he sat and listened to all the 4 parts. And so you have made me, you know, famous. Thank you. So this is a 42-year-old gentleman, type 2 diabetes for the past 4 years. He was diagnosed with diabetes after admission for acute coronary syndrome, after which he underwent angioplasty. So his diabetes itself was diagnosed when he presented with the acute coronary syndrome. So his admission A1C was 9.3. He was initially treated with insulin for 2 to 3 days. He was on an infusion protocol. And then when he got discharged, he was put on metformin and glimepiride. Initially on insulin infusion and then probably on a basal bolus, and then he was discharged on metformin and glimepiride. And his current medications are glimepiride 2 milligrams twice a day, metformin 500 milligrams twice a day, and voglibose 0.3 milligrams twice a day, something that I think many of us would use regularly in our practice, this particular regimen. He's a very, very active individual, running his own real estate business. He's busy from morning till late into night. And his present BMI is 26. At the time of diagnosis of his acute coronary syndrome and his diabetes, BMI was actually 31. So he actually has lost a lot of weight, whether it's from following a healthy diet and he lost the weight, or poor control of diabetes, I don't know. He claims to be on a healthy diet. Blood pressure is 128/76 on atenolol and telmisartan 40, and atorvastatin 40 milligrams a day. And I've given you his lipid profile. His LDL is something like 130, partly because he has a very low HDL. And his hemoglobin A1C is 8.1. He's on glimepiride, he's on metformin, and he's on voglibose. And his fasting sugar is 136, his 2-hour postprandial is 190. Kidney function tests are normal, and microalbumin is okay. So the questions are, or the issues with this gentleman are, his A1C is 8.1, his LDL is 130, his HDL is 25, triglycerides are 175, and he already has established coronary artery disease for a young man, and he has undergone angioplasty. So let me throw open to this audience, are you happy with this control? And the reason I'm asking this question, are you happy with this control, is, you know, we hear a lot about tight metabolic control does not improve cardiovascular risk, and tight metabolic control leads to this, and tight metabolic control leads to that. So are you happy with his control? And what do you think is likely the issue that is, in spite of being on these good medications, relatively short duration of diabetes, he's not in control, and what would you like to change? So I throw open to this audience, first question, happy with the control? No, okay, a show of hands, how many not happy? Okay, well, I think most are not happy, that's good news, okay. And so what is likely the issue why his control is still poor, in spite of being on a pretty, you know, decent amount of, he's lost weight, he's taking decent amount of medications, and likely issue here, renal function is okay. Lack of? No, he's very active. He says he's moving all the time. He's on a beta blocker, and so that is causing his poor control. Okay. Maybe his? His job? Yeah. Okay, real estate business can be stressful. Yeah, he's in a stressful job, and therefore his sugars are high, is what you're saying. His diet is not regular, okay. So, pardon? Maybe LADA, somebody says maybe LADA. See, he kind of started obese, so somewhat unlikely to be LADA. And he is behaving like a type 2 diabetes. Which is what? Okay. So he's supposed to be on voglibose, remember? So which is supposed to control postprandial hyperglycemia. See, the insulin part is addressed with the glimepiride. The insulin resistance part is addressed with the metformin. The postprandial and the, you know, absorption part is addressed with the voglibose. So other? So we'll go back to this ominous octet and say that we are not addressing some other things. So maybe we are not addressing neurotransmitter function, and we could give bromocriptine. Or we could address something like the increased glucose reabsorption and give SGLT2, which is not yet available. So that's not a problem. Pardon? I can't hear. To speak up. Could it be a sulfonylurea failure? Good question. Good answer. Yeah. Pardon? Okay. So all of these are very good answers. I will not belabor the point. I just want to say everything is a good answer, and I think contributes in some small way. But somebody brought up the thing about his work, and somebody brought up the thing about his diet and all that. So it's very important, actually, to any time you have someone who is not in control, you really expect them to be getting into better shape, they are not in control, to really sit down and go through their day and address their lifestyle and everything. Only then you'll actually be able to figure out what is wrong with this particular patient. So in this particular gentleman, what happened was he admitted to having a completely crazy day, very hectic schedule, depending upon the client and depending upon builder, he'll be all over the place. So for most parts, he's not taking Voglibose. Okay. And whenever he's eating very, very late, he skips the glimepiride because it has to be taken before the food, and so the issues are there. So his problem turned out to be a lot of matching his lifestyle and his food and his medications. If he took his glimepiride on time, but he could not eat on time, he felt all the symptoms of hypoglycemia. So he learned to avoid the medication, therefore he won't get hypoglycemic, or therefore he won't get the symptoms of hypoglycemia. So what happened with this gentleman was that he did not take his medications many of the times, because his lifestyle did not match the medications did not match his lifestyle. So what would you like to change? I think that will be the easy answer. Okay, so somebody wants to change his sulfonylurea. Not only should we consider changing the sulfonylurea for this particular reason, I also want to say that every time we have somebody with coronary artery disease, you really want to seriously look at agents like sulfonylurea and thiazolidinediones. Do we want to put the patient on those agents? And I'll show you a slide later for that. So Mr. K was changed to a DPP-4 inhibitor for the purpose of a glucose responsive action and nothing else. The glimepiride and this DPP-4 are probably going to do the same thing in terms of the A1C lowering. That's not the reason, because it's a more powerful agent. That was not the reason why it is changed. The reason it was changed is he was able to take a medication that is glucose responsive, so that even if he misses a meal, only when the sugar went up it would work. So he did not experience the hypoglycemia, and he took his medication. And we decreased the dosage of his glimepiride to 1 milligram twice a day. He was on 2 milligrams twice a day initially, and slowly over a period of time, I think he was able to come off. This is 3 months later, his A1C had already come down to 6.9, and his lipid profile had improved much more because we had changed him to rosuvastatin, and he was not taking his atorvastatin properly. Again, because of some muscle aches, we gave him vitamin D, started taking his statin more regularly, and we can see the lipid lowering. Why was he changed from atorvastatin to rosuvastatin? Any guesses? The HDL was so low, then we wanted to improve his HDL possibly, and you can see it went from 25 to 29, which is not a great shake, but I think it's still a significant improvement. So 3 months later, his A1C was 6.9 and his lipid profile had improved, and then we still felt that because he's already had an acute coronary event, his LDL should be below 70. So therefore, his rosuvastatin was further increased, and there was a reinforcement of his diet and activity. And we are hoping that sooner or later, we do not know if he'll even continue to need the glimepiride twice a day, or will he be able to manage with once a day, or even without it, we don't know. A higher dose of metformin maybe, and maybe he can come off the sulfonylurea. So the indication in some patients is really for the purpose of the glucose responsive effect of the incretin-based therapy. So knowing that our mortality rates are very high when it comes to cardiovascular disease, and particularly in India it is very, very high, we need to be cognizant of that fact and use agents that are not potentially unsafe for the patient with cardiac disease, and also use agents that they will take so that we can bring down their A1C. So here I want to just say good glycemic control improves outcomes, decreases cardiovascular risk. We're not talking about A1Cs driving it down to 6 and 6.2, but you definitely have to bring it down. And for someone who is only 42 years old, we definitely want to bring down the A1C. So this is the new guideline that they have put out, and I just want to, you know, show in this, they're not talking about postprandial control, they're not talking even about cardiovascular disease. Primarily, they're just talking about how to reach the A1C goal without weight gain, hypoglycemia, cost factor, and all of that. So in him, we chose to combine the metformin, the DPP-4 inhibitor, for the purpose of this key message, matching the lifestyle and the therapy. It's very, very important. And taking the history of the patient to find out how many medications they're actually taking and how much of them they're missing. So that is the first indication that I would say. And CV risk reduction should always be a consideration, because that is the biggest problem with diabetes management. Whatever it takes, lipid lowering, BP lowering, using the right agents, and bringing down the A1C should always be a consideration in managing diabetes. So patient number two. Any questions on patient number one so far? Would you have done anything differently? So it's not for hypertension. I think the cardiologist uses it from a different perspective. Okay, and I understand. So we'll have to send them back to the cardiologist and who's giving them medications and ask them to change it. Yeah. Correct. Correct. Yeah. Yeah. He was put on vitamin D, because that's what made him actually get less muscle ache with his statins. And we also know that there is evidence to say that statins themselves need vitamin D for their effect. So for both those reasons, vitamin D status must be appropriate in all our patients in whom we are using a statin. I'd rather give vitamin D than things like CoQ10 and other things, which really I don't think are doing much. Correct the vitamin D status first and give them supplemental vitamin D. Anything else? Pardon? Why? See, the plan is to somehow get him on a get him off the sulfonylurea if possible. And plus, because we are adding the DPP-4 inhibitor, even though his control is not good, we're not sure whether it will produce. When you leave them on a full dose of sulfonylurea and add the DPP-4, many patients can get hypoglycemic. And as I'll show you later, hypoglycemia is emerging as probably one of the biggest CV risk factors now. So one has to be very careful. I'm okay with a little bit of, if he goes into a little bit of poor control for a bit, and then we can straighten it out. So that's the reason. I definitely don't want to give him TZDs. I definitely, if the alpha glucosidase inhibitor can be, you want to look at the postprandial, and you want to look at the fasting, where is the problem, home glucose monitoring. So I definitely would consider something to improve the postprandial control. If that is either not an option, and if you have increased the metformin to 1 gram a day, I don't usually use more than. Which one? Which one? No, no, this particular patient, let me come to that. This particular patient did not tolerate more than 500 milligrams twice a day. Even earlier, he was suggested 1 gram twice a day. He did not tolerate it. So, no, I'm just saying, not in this patient. In any situation, I'd consider increasing the metformin. If that doesn't work, I would consider using a postprandial agent. If that doesn't work, you'll have to go to, if the fasting sugars are high, you'll have to consider a basal insulin. If they're overweight, you can consider even a GLP analog. I'm just saying, in patients in whom 42-year-old man with high CV risk, I want to make sure that I only pick agents that I know are potentially CV safe. You know, I can always bump up the glimepiride some more. Even glimepiride has not been proven that they are potentially unsafe. The ADA clearly says it is above glimepiride. It is not about glimepiride. And over again, they have said glimepiride is very safe in a cardiac patient. I'm not talking about post-CFD or post-30 days of CFD. It can be used No, no, no. That's not, let's, we shouldn't get emotional about this because, no. I'm saying I don't want, no. I'll explain to you why. See, we want to look at sulfonylureas not as, I'll tell you, their potential for increasing hypos, their potential for increasing weight gain. Okay, and as I show you the next patient and the following patient, that is really what is our concern. You know, the cardiac safety is still, I think the jury is out, though there is evidence to say that the European Heart Journal published a big study where they showed only glycoside was safer than the other agents. We have repeatedly, they have shown that sulfonylureas produce more hypoglycemia and produce more weight gain. And in, if you want to just take this particular patient, he's not feeling well with the sulfonylurea. He's feeling the symptoms of hypoglycemia, and therefore he's not taking even his medication. See, there is no point in all of us prescribing things if our patients won't take it. In a previous Dibicon, I have talked about, given the history of my own father who fell down and fractured his leg, and we found his A1C was 9.4. He was supposed to have been on a glimepiride metformin combination, and we said, now things are bad, we're going to put you on an insulin, and that's when he said, don't tell your mother, I'm not taking any of the medicines. And that's because every time I take it, I feel lightheaded, so I've stopped taking everything. So we want to give medicines people will take. We want to make sure that it will not cause hypos. We want to give medicines that will not promote weight gain, and we want to make sure that at least there is no cloud of possible CV. That's why I showed that slide of the amount of cardiovascular disease that we have, that in small ways, if we can decrease the risk, or in small ways, if we can, you know, make sure that we don't increase the risk, I think that is the onus is on us to do that. There will be patients whose control will be poor, and we have to increase their sulfonylurea, knowing that these things are happening. There will be patients in whom we cannot give a DPP-4 because of cost issues. I'm just saying you would want to weigh these risk and benefit, and whoever can afford and whoever can take it, you should consider an agent that doesn't do all of these things. And I just want to tell you, glibenclamide is the least safe because of the greatest risk with hypoglycemia with that drug, nothing else. The greatest risk of hypoglycemia is with glibenclamide. Okay. Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. He did not seem. You can't make people tell people. We tell them you eat on time, you do everything properly. It's all that preaching we always do. But that's their lifestyle. He says, when my client calls, I have to go. When my builder comes, I have to go. When my architect comes, I have to go. And I just can't have that kind of a 9-to-5 banker's hours. Not possible. So we'll have to work with his lifestyle. So you'll see this as we go along. This is a 44-year-old lady diagnosed with type 2 diabetes for 1 year only. She underwent thyroidectomy for a multinodular goiter, causing pressure and aerodigestive issues. And at that time, during the preoperative exam, they found that she has type 2 diabetes. She had been told to have pre-diabetes almost 7 years ago. And what happened, unfortunately, was her BMI is 32 with a weight gain of 8 kilos after surgery. And she has had also leg edema for nearly 3 years now. Her blood pressure is 140 to 96. Lipids are, as you can see, LDL is 144, A1C is 7.8, and fasting sugar is 138, and postprandial is 214. Okay? Now, her present medicines. Glycoside, 40, plus metformin, 500 twice a day. Pioglitazone, 3.75 a day. Exact prescriptions. I'm not treating these people, by the way. These are people who come to me with these kind of crazy prescriptions, and my job is to straighten it out. Voglibose plus metformin, 0.2 and 500 combination pill twice a day. Amlodipine 5 milligrams, and thyroxine 125, and calcium 500. So, bizarre. So, what are your concerns in this patient? Okay, weight gain. A1C is still suboptimal on 4 drugs. That's also our concern. And what are the thoughts on pioglitazone? Just the fact you all laughed, I know your thoughts. And what would you modify about this patient? is leg edema a concern and should we add a statin? These are all the issues in the management of this particular patient. So I'll go back to the medications, and you know the A1C is 7.8. She's only 44. She's had diabetes only for 1 year. Yeah. So I'll open this to you. You tell me, what do you want to change? What are your concerns in this patient? Okay, edema may be due to amlodipine, so that's a good point, and maybe we'll have to rearrange the amlodipine and see what happens. And pioglitazone. And I just want to tell you, apparently she was on something like 15, gained more weight, then they brought it to 7, and then they said, okay, you'll be on 3.75. My answer to this is, some things like 3.75 probably has no effect and no side effect, or no effect and some side effects, but definitely no effect. So TSH levels, okay, thank you, that's a very good question. So 3.75 is something that should not be on board, and just unnecessarily we are adding more medications that are not doing anything and potentially adding to the problems to the patient. We don't know. And some medications, you know, are there are hypersensitivity reactions, and you know 3.75 can do the same thing that a 30 milligram can do. So let's not do this. So pioglitazone is out of the picture. Now the biggest concern about this patient is her weight gain. Okay, there are many reasons for the weight gain. It could have been the pioglitazone, it could have been the sulfonylurea that she's on, it could be that after surgery she decided to take it easy and stay home and somebody else was doing all the work and therefore the weight gain happened. So we really don't know. And the leg edema also, I think we can think it's due to the amlodipine or we can think it's due to the pio, but we should give it a little bit more thought, because I want to mention that women with diabetes, much higher incidence of heart failure than men with diabetes, much higher. So she needs to be given a proper look at the leg edema also. Is it something else? Is it nephrotic syndrome? Is it, you know, something to do with the liver? Is it heart failure? So only after you have made sure, or it can even be varicose veins, only after you have ruled all that out, then you can say, okay, I'll stop the amlodipine, see what happens. I'll ask her to lose weight, see what happens. Or it could be anemia. So the leg edema also is something that should be seriously looked at. And then now tell me about this this glycoside metformin, voglibose metformin, what should we do? Okay. So personally, I feel that we also should be looking at agents that do not promote weight gain. And we know that sulfonylureas, TZDs, and insulin promote weight gain. So if you want to consider that, that is something to look at. And I told you A1C is still suboptimal on 4 drugs, and so let's go there. So it came in a. No. They were taking it like she was taking it like she was supposed to take it, and you know that voglibose metformin combination is everywhere, and it is here to stay. So the pioglitazone was stopped, and exactly what you said, you can see. The voglibose was given alone, because my concern was the same thing. All these things that were done by me. When the presenting histories, they come from someone else to me. So pio was stopped, voglibose was given alone. And what I did was, you know, I truly believe that ease of administration is very important to improve compliance. If you give them a simpler schedule, people are likely to stick to it. If you say you take this before and after, you take this with the first bite of meal, you take this half an hour later, and this you take at bedtime, no one's going to do more than 70-80% of that. Very few will be completely compulsive about it and following all these instructions. So DPP-4 and metformin 1000 was started, because she was already on with the glycoside 500, She's already with the Voglibose 500. So what I did was with the DPP-4, I added, made it 1,000 and gave it, and glycoside was decreased first to once a day and then gradually over a period of time. As you can see, patient gradually began to lose weight, not just because the pio was stopped, multiple things. She was also reinforced about weight reduction and the importance of that. And she was on less sulfonylureas, off the pioglitazone, things were improved. And her A1C is now 6.7 because she's sticking to the schedule. And now she's only on the DPP-4 plus metformin and plus some Voglibose. She's not even on glycoside anymore. So this is something to keep in mind. This is an option for patients in home. You are finding weight gain happening and you still don't find the, you know, control is not poor. So once a day. Once. It's now available as once daily combinations, slow release and all that. So the challenge for us now is mostly this hypoglycemia and the weight gain while trying to bring the A1C down, how not to get do both. And so reaching the A1C goal without weight gain has become really, really important. How many of you have heard of the study called the Look Ahead study? The Look Ahead study was done by the NIH. It's a long study on comparing intensive lifestyle modification with conventional lifestyle modification. They did it for several years with the simple question of finding out what happens to CV risk. Recently, just 2 weeks ago, they halted the study because they did not find any change. Very disappointing. That lifestyle modification, intensive versus conventional, did not show the improvement in cardiovascular risk. Even though A1C came down, even though fasting sugar came down, HDL went up a little bit, and triglycerides came down. LDL is the only one that didn't change. It did all of these things and still the patient did not improve, in no benefit of cardiovascular risk reduction. So the moral of the story is, try not to make weight gain happen. Weight loss is becoming very difficult and we're not even sure what is going to happen, because I'll show you something that happens with weight gain. Some of you who have attended my talks may have seen this slide. This is from the lead trials. All the six lead trials, the liraglutide trials, they collected all the information, all the intention to treat analysis. And what they found was, for every 1% reduction in A1C, if you either gained 3 kilos weight or had more 30% hypoglycemia, it negated that benefit. So it's no more reaching the A1C goal, you know, okay, whatever happens, I want to drive it down. If you do it along the way with weight gain or hypoglycemia, you're going to lose that A1C benefit. So forget weight loss, no weight gain. So weight neutrality has become an important thing, which is why I want to show you, when the goal is to avoid weight gain, the only two agents in that big list I showed you, the only two things that we have are GLP agonists and DPP-4. GLP receptor agonists actually promote weight loss, which is a good thing, but you know, it is something that is an injection, and it is something that even was actually, you know, discussed with this particular patient. And even though she did not have thyroid cancer or anything, she had read about liraglutide and thyroid cancer, even though it was only in rodent models. She had already heard about it and did not want to go there. Plus it's an injection. So we decided to stick with this and she's done well. So this is another indication where you do not want weight gain. Third one. 47-year-old gentleman has type 2 diabetes only for the past 6 months, which he detected during his master health checkup. Initial A1C was 7.6, fasting sugar was 114 and PP was 186. Initial BMI 27, blood pressure was a little high and his LDL was a little high. He was started on metformin 500 twice a day, follows the diet in very, very, very active person, travels 14 to 16 days in a month. So he recently made his metformin once a day because of flatulence. He's CFO or CEO or something like that. He said he was in meetings and it was embarrassing and he had a lot of flatulence, and therefore he cut down the metformin. And in fact, his itching to totally stop it because he felt so much relief when he cut down the metformin to half. And when he came to see me, his A1C was 7.4 when he cut down the metformin. He's very engaged in his diabetes, reads a lot, and he actually wanted to know about newer agents, bringing his A1C down. And also, he had actually asked about oral insulin also. So this is the kind of patient who does not tolerate metformin. So what is the next best add-on to metformin? That's the million-dollar question in type 2 diabetes management. Is it SU, is it TZD, is it DPP-4, GLP agonist, basal insulin, or is it alpha-glucosidase inhibitor or meglitinide? What do you add next? So that is the perfect doctor who picks the perfect one for his perfect patient. So that. So what would be your next choice and why? And what should be his A1C? Here is a guy who's 47. Just 6 months ago, he had type 2 diabetes. His A1C was 7.6. It's come down to 7.4. He doesn't tolerate metformin. You know, chances are he'll have to go off this 500 also, most likely. And what should be his A1C? How much? Less than 7. Anybody else? Gopi says 6.5. We'll agree with the chair. Okay, somewhere bit closer to 6.5 because you always want to give them some wiggle room to 7. They'll go from 6.5 to 7, come back, go to 6.5, 7 and come back. If you keep it at 7, they'll go to 7.5 and come back. So you want to give the wiggle room closer to 6.5 so that you're always below 7. I'm not saying you want to drive it to 6 or 6.2 and all those things. That's what happened in some of the intensively controlled trials where there was a risk of hypo and where there was some risk of cardiovascular disease. How many of you believe in metabolic memory? Okay, only 6-7 people? Okay, so the metabolic memory or the legacy effect, is what is actually telling me that his A1C should be made below 7 ASAP. Because the metabolic memory is all about that. And then the question is, should he even be on metformin? Can he just be on, some other agent without the metformin? It depends on how much he tolerates. I'd love to leave everybody on metformin because we're learning more about metformin every single day. It abrogates cancer risk, it improves CV risk, improves the CV risk factors, it could do this, increases GLP levels. So, sarvaroga nivarani. So, we want to use metformin. So we know from the UKPDS control and the DCCT EDICT data that definitely early onset of glucose control, bringing the A1C below 7, long-term benefits are reaped. And you can see that 16% was not statistically significant in 1997. 15% became statistically significant in 2007, and they showed that long-term CV benefits were there. So the new paradigm is this. We have a narrow window of opportunity early on when you want to bring down that A1C from 8.5 or 9 or whatever down to 7. I'm not saying in 3 months. In this picture, they've shown 8.5 to 7 in 3 months. That is, I think, can be quite rapid. You just want to bring it down as early as possible, as quickly as possible, but that's the goal. Every 3 months you keep checking and doing whatever it takes, whether it's reinforcing, more education, adding a new agent, changing the agent, whatever it takes to bring down the A1C to the goal range, making sure along the way we don't do harm to the patient by gaining more weight or causing more hypos or promoting CV risk. We don't want all that. So early diagnosis, early therapy are the key to reap the benefit of the metabolic memory. So early optimization, not aggressive therapy, but early optimization is the new mantra in management of type 2 diabetes. So in what we did with him was, we left him on 500 milligrams of metformin, added a DPP-4 inhibitor. His A1C came down very nicely to 6.5 or 6.6, brought down his metformin to 250. I've kept him at 250 and he tolerates it well without any side effects, and he's on once daily DPP-4 inhibitor. So early optimization is the new mantra. Okay. Now comes the older patient, 76-year-old lady, diabetic for 12 years, has undergone hip fracture surgery recently. She's been on glibenclamide and metformin for the past 12 years. During the hospital stay, she was treated with insulin for the hip surgery. She also has CKD, mild CKD, BUN of 34 and creatinine of 1.8, and her last A1C was 7.2. Okay, 76-year-old lady, BMI 27, menopause at 52, always been on calcium vitamin D, amlodipine 2.5 and telmisartan 20, frequent episodes of lightheadedness, BP 138-90, and the lipid profile is quite okay. So the question in this, since it seems to be the issue with this person, her A1C is 7.2. Are we happy with this A1C in this lady? Should we lower it further? And what would be a better agent for her? So possibly this dizziness is some hypoglycemia, possibly it is something else, maybe some sick sinus syndrome, older lady, maybe something else. So that needs to be evaluated, why she's having the lightheadedness. And I actually want to tell you, if at all possible, whenever you have issues like this, if you can even do it, a CGMS is a beautiful tool. You can do the CGMS and document when patient feels lightheaded and their blood sugar. It will be a wonderful way of objectively documenting the cause of this, if at all possible. It's like a Holter monitor for our blood sugars, which is very, very nice. And are you happy with the A1C? Yes? No? 7.2? Elderly person, 7.2, everybody is happy, right? Okay. Okay. Not too? Not too concerned, okay. I want to tell you, who said that? Who said life expectancy is limited? No. I want to tell you something. Have you talked to some 75-year-olds lately? My father was reading a paper and he said, Pao and Chinnavis, a 75-year-old man had, remember, you know, it was actually Yasser Arafat when he died, saying, so sad, Pao, Chinnavis, Lepetar. And I said, Chinnavis, he's 75. He said, 75 life, onume ille. So their goalpost will keep changing. So when you hit 80, 90, my grandmother died 3 months ago at the age of 96. And she told me about 5 years ago, no, just one more year you keep me alive, as if it's in my hands. Because she wanted to see my daughter get married. So that goalpost moved to 2 years ago when my daughter got married. She said, "Inno 2 years because I want to see her baby." So I want to just tell you, be very careful when you say this life expectancy business, okay? Life expectancy is definitely something we want to talk about. I take care of patients in the Adyar Cancer Institute. There we should talk about it. Or we talk about it in patients who have, you know, serious other medical issues. But this whole age business, I agree with you. I'll show you the slide. We want to be careful about not very being too aggressive, and you know, I definitely will never use glibenclamide in a 72-year-old patient. So that's what I wanted to say. And let's not, pardon? Creatinine is 1.8. Some people use metformin with creatinine of 1.8. They're very comfortable. I am not. I am very risky, old age. Person already having some episodes, I don't know what she's having, and then the creatinine is higher. So I'm really uncomfortable with this. So this is the thing, which target for whom is the essence. So if you're comfortable with, if you're comfortable with a 7.5 or 7.2 and even up to 8 in some very old individuals, I'm actually very comfortable. If you have fixed that target, then you work towards that, okay? So, and definitely you don't want to. So the complications of sequelae of hypoglycemia could be cardiac, it could be, you know, CNS, like possibly she could be having syncopal episodes. And after going into the history, we found it's during one of those episodes she fell and fractured her hip. Just like what happened to my dad. So those are all things, see, because people with diabetes have vision issues, coordination issues, neuropathy issues, and on top of that, if we add hypo and give them dizziness also, then I don't think we are doing a good job. So individualized targets, less is more, not less A1C, I'm talking about less medications. Less is more should be the philosophy in elderly patients. So as few medications, as comfortable for them with a liberalized goal, it should be the way. So coming to the, I think last but one, 69-year-old gentleman, diabetic for nearly 22 years. After many combinations of OHAs, he's now on pre-mix of 70-30, 22 in the morning and 18 in the evening, undergone CABG angioplasty. His A1C is 6.7. Fasting sugar is 86 and his PP is 196. He has several episodes of shortness of breath and chest discomfort during the day. His activity is limited due to that and his BMI is 24. Okay. So what should be his A1C? Again, this is a 69-year-old. 69 again is quite young, and seriously young. Okay. Hillary Clinton is 65 and she could be the president in the next 4 years. So 69 is young. But the thing is, his CABG and angioplasty and all this chest discomfort, that bothers me. And he's already had macrovascular disease. You know, what are we doing with this glucose control? We need to revisit that. And 6.7, so I want to tell you, when you see an A1C, it is a composite of high sugars and low sugars. So sometimes when you see a very good-looking A1C, it could also be because they're having a lot of hypos. So keep that in mind. And what should be his A1C? I think we're all agreed that it can be up to 7.5. Do you think all OHAs should be stopped after insulin is initiated? That used to be the thinking, because you know that he's been diabetic for 22 years and he's actually been seeing one of my own professors, and he sent him to me and I had to change the professor's prescription, which is not a, you know, it's a very difficult thing. So should all OHAs be stopped? No. In fact, the guidelines say that metformin should stay from beginning to end. We can also use other agents, so they can use less insulin. And what's the best way to know his glucose control? I already mentioned, you know, CGMS would be very nice, because it's like, you know, if we did a CGMS, we would know if his episodes of chest pain can be linked to his hypoglycemia. So he underwent CGMS, showed several episodes of hypoglycemia, 54 to 66, and he had chest discomfort during those episodes. So we stopped cut down his insulin a lot and added a DPP-4 inhibitor and a metformin. Lot better now. His A1C is still the same, but I'm happy with that. I'm happy, no, it was 6 point something, right? Yeah, 6.7, it's actually gone up. But I'm happy with that, because he's not having any more, he's not symptomatic anymore, and he's doing very well. So just to show you a couple of evidence for this, in this particular CGMS study, they showed that symptomatic and asymptomatic episodes of hypoglycemia, more of them were associated with chest pain and angina. And this is a CGMS study, and that's what I wanted to impress upon how. And also want to show you this very interesting data. We always thought that hyperglycemia was associated with inflammatory markers, whether IL, interleukins, or CRPs, or TNF-alpha. This is a hypo. See what happens the moment they become hypoglycemic, all things start going up, which can actually have lasting effect on the cardiovascular system. One hypoglycemic episode, see what happens to the interleukins and TNF-alpha. So very important to know that this new concept, that very nice article on hypoglycemia, I urge everybody to read, which shows that hypoglycemia is now associated with inflammation, things like VEGF, IL-6, CRP, goes up. Endothelial function goes down, or endothelial dysfunction is happening. And we already know sympathoadrenal responses are happening. When the blood sugar comes down, when it hits about 80, insulin will shut it off. Then when it goes down, you know, glucagon and catecholamines, epinephrine, cortisol, growth hormone, they'll all start coming. So all the sympathoadrenal responses are happening. Plus, there are blood coagulation abnormalities that are happening in patients as well. It's associated not only with patient-reported treatment dissatisfaction, patient gets hypo, after that they won't continue the treatment, and health status and cost is more when people become hypo. So many implications for hypoglycemia that we are learning more and more and more. Very important ones that are emerging are cardiovascular risk and autonomic dysfunction abnormalities and adherence to treatment. So we need to be aware of that. So hypo is bad for the body and mind, and avoid it at all cost, and that's pun intended. So if you have to use an agent that's a little bit more expensive so you can avoid the hypoglycemia, please do that, so that the patient will not get one episode and one hospitalization will make up for the amount that they'll pay for a medication. So in health economics, you kind of have to also look at those things. So if you want to avoid hypoglycemia, the agents that we really have are the TZDs and the DPP-4s and the GLP. And again, I want to tell you, I don't use TZDs at all for all those other reasons which I have mentioned before. And between DPP-4 and GLP agonists, you have to choose. Is the patient grossly overweight? Can they, take an injection? And, those concerns. But otherwise, you want to use one of these agents. So, should I stop, Raghu? No.
Yes.
Three more minutes, okay. So 43-year-old lady has diabetes for 11 years. She had GDM about 4 years prior to her diagnosis. Undergone laser photocoagulation for retinopathy. Undergone surgical menopause at the age of 39 for endometrial cancer. BMI is 28, but she's been up to 31. Blood pressure is high, but is on ARBs and hydrochlorothiazide. LDL is okay, but triglycerides are high, and creatinine is 2.2. And very erudite lady, works as an e-publisher. Okay, so why I'm putting this up is her current medications. She takes glargine 22 units at night, lispro 12, 6, and 6, voglibose 0.3 twice a day, glipizide 2.5 twice a day, and her most recent A1C is 8.6. So endometrial cancer, high blood pressure, high triglycerides, high A1C, woman, early menopause. So I called her a train wreck. And that's exactly what she is, a complete train wreck, which we need to fix one by one by one, put the train back together, so, and take care of all the problems. And this is, should we change her medicines because of her CKD? So one of the advantages of the newer agents are that they can be used in patients with renal disease, and the newer linagliptin and others can be actually used even in ESRD. So that is something to keep in mind. Does the diagnosis of cancer change anything medication wise? Any of these medicines you'll worry about? Glargine maybe? Yes? How many think that glargine causes cancer? Only one. Okay, so we can change that mind. Basically, after the Origin trial, even though the Origin did not show improvement in cardiovascular risk, and Origin did not show that benefit, it clearly proved one thing, that glargine does not cause cancer. Does not increase the risk of cardiovascular disease. These two things, I think it proved beyond doubt. So I'm not worried about cancer risk in any of these patients. Why I put this cancer is, you know that people worry about DPP-4 inhibitors and cancer because of the CD4 counts and how it works. So again, there has been evidence to show there are no signals in terms of, and when you have metformin on board, it abrogates that increased cancer risk, but because of the CKD, we'll have to be careful about the metformin. So does the presence of microvascular complications deter tight control in your mind? 43 years old, should she have tight control? Her A1C should be where? Where should her A1C? She's already had photocoagulation, already has renal dysfunction. Pardon? 7.5? Less than 7. I would agree, okay, that we want to be careful and probably bring her to less than 7, because if there is one area where Unequivocally, we have learned that good control is good in microvascular complications. And she has not developed macrovascular complications. So controlling her BP, controlling her lipids, bringing down her A1C, all of this is very, very important. And that's where I would... So microvascular complications can be delayed or prevented by good control. And this is something that we want to always keep in mind and not get swayed by these Accord VADT and advanced studies that tight control is bad. Tight control is good. We just don't want super tight control and get them into hypoglycemia. So the last one is the lady I just saw this morning. 80-year-old lady diagnosed to have diabetes on 29th of September in Singapore, when her fasting sugar was 217. So immediately she was started on glycoside and metformin twice a day. She came to see me today. Her A1C is 6.8. Fasting blood sugar is 133. 2-hour PP is 178 without any medicines. Okay, so here is a patient who is 80 years old, and we really want to be extremely careful about using agents like sulfonylureas and all that, and what kind of target that we want to pick. I would be very happy if somebody just gave her metformin and saw what happened. And if metformin is not tolerated by her for any reason, I'd be very happy in this patient with a small dose of a DPP-4 inhibitor once a day. That's it. Because she, according to her son who brought her to me, said clearly does pujas till 11 a.m., 12, you know, noon, does not eat anything, so many days of upavas and, you know, sashti, so she doesn't eat on so many days. So one has to be very careful about somebody like this and prescribing things like glycoside for her. So that's what I want. So I think a lot is wrong with this management in this particular patient. So let me conclude by saying that type 2 diabetes management is complicated because we can't get 24-hour control with many of the agents. There is lack of long-term control. The A1C keeps going up. Complex dosing regimens are around, which makes it difficult. We know that many of the drugs are associated with increased CV risk. And as it is, the problem causes decline in renal function and hepatic function, and we need to match our medications. And most importantly, last but not the least, is hypo and weight gain, which needs to be in our radar all the time. And which is why the new guidelines, which is patient-centered medicine, gives us a lot of latitude, where the approach is completely depending upon patient's attitude and expectations from treatment. Like the CFO who wants to bring it down and keep it down has heard of metabolic memory and legacy effect, to the person, you know, much older and just wants to be out of trouble, attitude and expected treatment effects and risks associated with hypo, disease duration, life expectancy, as you had said, and important comorbidities, established vascular complications and resources and support system, which is definitely, you know, I don't know whether it should be at the top of the list, very, very important, so that patients can take the medications we are prescribing to them. So coming back to this, this is a wonderful roadmap that we have. It's still a roadmap, but we need to actually find out a lot about each individual patient that we are treating, so we can find out which one is suiting to our particular patient and their lifestyle and their comorbidities, life, everything. So I'll conclude by saying that I think the DPP-4 inhibitors are a valuable addition to our existing armamentarium. Because I have been specifically given this topic and where to position it, I'm saying that these are all the areas where you would want a glucose responsive effect, where you don't want hypo, where you don't want weight gain, where there is CKD, or where you want to use a single agent. So these are all the places where I could consider that, or where other things are contraindicated, like TZDs in women. It can be used early in the problem, or it can even be used later on to cut down the dosage of insulin or other medications that are causing weight gain. So I think we need to use it prudently, and it's a good tool that we have. Thank you.
I think it's time up. And it was an excellent presentation. I think she has given us so many scenarios. And I would say that gliptins are like a joker card. It suits with any thing can be
fitted and it can be prescribed very easily. And I think so, because of lack of time, we can have the discussion during the tea time. Thank you.
You can write down your questions and keep it ready. You can shoot it during the panel discussion.
And I would request Dr. Ravindra to give a moment of a ma'am. We'll all come back by 5:15 for the next topic. Thank you.
We'll adjourn for tea now. Welcome back after the tea. The next topic is a very important topic, day-to-day problem which we handle every day in and day out. Problems in the management of diabetic nephropathy.